Hello and welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Dr. Shravani Basu, Assistant Professor in the Department of English in St. Francis College for Women in Hyderabad. The lesson that we would be looking at today is on the African and Caribbean poetry, a kind of an overview of it in the paper African and Caribbean Writing in English. Now, this module attempts to give an overview of the poetry from two different geographical areas, the Caribbean islands and Africa. But some might ask that why are we clubbing Caribbean island, the poetry from the Caribbean islands and the poetry from the different nations of Africa? The kind of justification might be that both these geographic areas, they share a complicated colonial history and influences, and both these areas write in many languages other than English. But for convenience and for a smoother lesson planning, this lesson would focus more on Anglophone Caribbean and African poetry. Now, when we come at African poetry, we see that there is a tendency amongst the critics and the scholars together to club poetry of Africa, assuming that there is a pan-African ethos, a pan-African characteristic which embodies in the entire oeuvre of African poetry. Though, very clearly, there are geographical, racial and temporal differences in colonialism, struggles for independence and the post-colonial politics in each country of Africa, which reflects and also contributes to the creation of the canon of African poetry. The regionalism adds an indigenous poetic tradition, makes it all the more complicated than theorizing the pan-Caribbean African poetry. Now, one of the easier method of categorizing African poetry is of course based on language, which majorly depends on the colonial influences. The practice of assimilation and regrouping of the tribes followed by France and Portugal during the colonial era rewrote the history of African countries almost forever. Now, in a way, this gave rise to this colonial oppression and this attempt to colonial hegemony gave rise to an attempt of counter-hegemony through negritude, which asserted African traditions and reclaimed their identities through a pride in blackness. Negritude thus became a social as well as literary response to colonialism, and two of the behemoths, Leopold Sedar Senghor and Aimé Césaire, looked into the use of indigenous languages in explaining their positions in political struggle as well as literary iconography. Now, European languages and pidgin version as well as dialects are also mixed in most of the literary works of Africa. And at the same time, it brings together Anglophone, Francophone and Lusophone linguistic traditions in the African poetry and our understanding of it. For the post-colonial Africa, with its diverse regional as well as colonial linguistic influences, multiplicity and the related struggles define their very identity and tradition. Now, in African poetry, the first poet that we would be looking at is a Nigerian poet called Christopher Ifeakandu Okibo. Now, Okibo was one of the traditional African poets of Nigeria and who was influenced heavily by Greek, Latin and European literature and traditions. And he was also very heavily taking from modernist poetry by T.S. Eliot and Ezra Pound, and he was influenced by their writing style and choice of themes. He died in the Suka battlefront while fighting for the Biafran independence war. His contribution to African poetry has always been considered immense. He explored the themes that vary from war to nature, tradition to modernism, spirituality and freedom, and a kind of relationship with the African individual to the muse of nature. The passage, one of his most famous poem places nature on a supreme pedestal, and Okibo considers nature to be his muse. The next poet that we would look at is John Pepper Clark, who again is from Nigeria. We will see that a lot of Anglophone writers, playwrights and poets are from Nigeria, because probably Nigeria is one of the most predominantly English-speaking country in the African continent. Now, Clark wrote poems that highlighted the stark realities of Nigeria and of Africa. So it's a little different from the natural, the proliferation of nature in Okibo's poems before. The political and the social symbols that he chose to point towards is a critical view of the national and the international relations. Though the symbols and themes overtly appear to be simple, the politics of national and humanity and international humanity were openly criticized in his works. And he was also, of course, the part of the Nigerian Civil War, and the contrasting images of war and peace appeared in some of his poems. He's again considered, together with Wole Soyinka and Okibo, to be one of the previous generation of poets, the traditionalists. His book, The Casualties, Poems 1966-68, describes the cruelties and violence happening during the Nigerian and Biafran Civil War. And through his poems, Clark, in a way, contributes to the building and imagination of a post-colonial Nigeria. Now, Mazisi Kunin is South African. But the funny thing about Mazisi Kunin is that he writes in Zulu language. He is one of the modernist trendsetters of African poetry, and he tries to move away from the traditional classical influences in his writing styles. He keenly observed and had a deep knowledge about the poetic techniques in the traditional Zulu poetry, the oral poetic tradition. He was against the following the traditional paths, like poets like Okibo and Clark, and he wanted a more analytical documentation of the South African political and social scenario. Now, his 1970 anthology called Zulu Poems was a collection of his translated poems from Zulu to English. One of the most famous poems was Emperor Shaka the Great, an epic poem that narrated the life and history of a Zulu leader. And in a way, it's also a narrative of the history of Zulu language. Now, an Ugandan poet called Okot P. Bitek, very similar to Kunin's technique of using long poem narrative, also gained tremendous recognition for his epic poem Song of Lawino. His long poem portrayed the life of a rural African wife whose husband is trapped in a westernized lifestyle. It depicts the contrast between the rural life and modernized city life through the characters of the husband and the wife. Moreover, the poem describes the struggle of a modern man who finds it difficult to choose between the dualities of tradition and modernity, and of blackness and whiteness. Okot P. Bitek is also the founder of the Okot School of Poetry, which is a developing genre in African poetry in which works follow a verse monologue technique in traditional song form. It's also called the East African Song School. And the Song of Lawino had a sequel which Okot wanted to be the husband's reply to the wife, which was called Song of Okol. Now, very famous poet Gabriel Okara is again from Nigeria. Some of you might recognize the name of Gabriel Okara because his very famous poem Piano and Drums is studied in many of the colleges and university as a part of their curriculum, their undergraduate curriculum. Now, the extreme dichotomies of life, especially the experiences between the European influences and the African traditions, are intensely depicted in his poems. The symbolic landscapes and the African imageries, the robustness of African imagery, of African drums, of African settings, in contrast to, in a way, his diluted perception of European landscape features in most of his poems, like Once Upon a Time and Piano and Drum, which deals with the contrast and the conflict between the old customs and traditions of Africa that are being threatened by the European manipulating powers. Now, the next poet that we are looking at is Kofi Awunor of Ghana. Now, Kofi Awunor, very importantly, was born in an Ewe ethnic group in Ghana. Awunor's grandmother was a Ewe dirge singer, and he was influenced by the Ewe music and culture tradition, which he tried again to incorporate into his verses. Awunor gave his ethnic cultures a platform to develop as well as influence other cultures. At the same time, this technique can be seen as a way of resisting European and American influences on the African ethnicities. Other major themes were religion, spirituality, philosophy, life and death, and also the idea of exile. One of the most famous of his collected poems is Rediscovery and Other Poems, which was published in 1964. Again, similar to other African poets, Awunor has also followed a path to rediscover the identity of the self through poetry and imagination. The dirge form that he imbibed from his childhood days, under the influence probably of his grandmother, blended with an urge to hold on to ethnic traditions, constituting the major, it was the major theme of the majority of his plays. And he also very unfortunately died in a terrorist attack in Nairobi in Kenya. Now, James David Rubadri is a Malawi poet, and he's also a playwright and novelist. Rubadri places himself as one of the major poets who focuses on the cultural and political changes in post-independent Africa. Although he doesn't deny the relationship between colonialism and the present-day African poetry, Rubadri highlights the resistance of African traditions on westernization. One of his famous poems, An Africa Thunderstorm, clearly depicts the African predicament of fighting against the storm that comes from the West that would take away their ethnic and religious cultures and traditions. Now, so far we looked into many of the poets like Okibo, like Clark, Gabriel Okara, Kunisi, like Rubadri, of African poetic tradition, and it's also very clear that each one of them come from different nationality, and even their poetic imagination is very different from each other, though there are certain very stark similarities between their representation of the African nationhood, poetic imagination, and also literary sensibilities. Now, the next poetic form or the poetic oeuvre that we would be looking at is the Caribbean poetic oeuvre. Now, the Caribbean region, with its diverse cultural identities and complex histories, has produced evocative works of art that devote itself to a struggle to find the roots and identities. Some of you might be familiar with the time when during the British rule, thousands of immigrants from India, from different parts of India, like Tamil Nadu, like UP, like Haryana, like Madhya Pradesh and Bengal, they were taken from the Indian subcontinent, and they emigrated to the Caribbean peninsula, particularly in Mauritius, which they used to call Marichdeep, as a part of an indentured labor system. Now, they settled in different Caribbean islands, and they later formed the majority of the Caribbean population. Their descendants are still there. Now, this proves in a way what strangely multicultural and multi-ethnic society the Caribbean islands are. Now, categorizing Caribbean poetry and poets is in itself a very complicated task, because we need to arrange these poets according to language, as they speak Creole, different forms of Creole, French, Spanish, Dutch, and English according to the colonial influences. Now, for convenience, again, we would be looking at the Anglophone Caribbean poetry tradition. Now, slavery, colonial rule, struggle for independence, freedom, post-colonialism, globalization, culture, language, nation, and identity are some of the more common and recurrent themes in Caribbean poetry in general. Now, adding to these themes, certain poets who have moved out of their homelands to America, the diasporic Caribbean poets in Canada and Europe, have their own different perspective and understanding of their island. Now, poets like Derek Walcott, Edward Kamu Brathwaite, Linton Kwesi Johnson, who is more popularly known as LKJ, Louisa Bennett are some of the poets who have created an outsider point of view of their lands. Now, some of the major poets from the West Indies are Edward Waugh, who hails from Jamaica, Louisa Bennett, again from Jamaica, John Agard from Guyana, Merle Collins from Grenada, Cyril W. Dean from Guyana, Derek Walcott from St. Lucia, David W. Dean again from Guyana, James Berry from Jamaica, Grace Nichols, Guyana, Brian Chan from Guyana, Lorna Goodison from Jamaica, Cecil Gray from Trinidad and Tobago, and many others. Now, when we look at the Caribbean settler experience, the Caribbean is a country which is full of, is a place, is a nationhood which is full of various migrants, and they are known as the archetypical migrant space. The Caribbean islands, each of the nations under the Caribbean peninsula, they are a topsy-turvy mixture of migrant spaces with multiple diasporic instincts. Now, language, if we look at the language of the Caribbean poetry, there are two major languages which are used in writing poetry, that is French and English. And the current major characteristic of the language which is used in Caribbean poetry is also the use of Creole. Now, Edward Kamu Brathwaite created the idea of a nation language by elevating the language of slaves and other people who were brought into the Caribbean islands to a national level. So this elevation of Creole into a national language, which for some countries like Mauritius fell horribly flat because a lot of members of the Mauritian societies rebelled against the idea of having Creole as a part of their national consciousness, because to them Creole was a substandard mongrelized language which they needed but which they don't really recognize themselves with. Now, this nation language is thus a way of reclaiming a Caribbean identity which is independent from the influences of colonialism and colonial history. Through nation language, writers claim their individual identity and the identity also as the people. Even though not all poets followed Brathwaite's idea of nation. The quest for a distinct way of expressing their identity can be seen in most of the Caribbean poets. Other than the different European languages, which were a tradition, a heritage which they got from their European colonizers, the Creolization also gave rise to a more number of languages and dialects that are blends of European, African, Asian, and indigenous voices. Now, the other point that we look at, the recurrent theme that we look at in Caribbean poetry tradition are Rastafarianism, Regga, and Dove movement. And some of you might recognize the word Regga because the most celebrated Caribbean singer, Bob Marley, was an adherent of this tradition. Now, the Rastafari movement is an Afrocentric religious movement based in the Caribbean island of Jamaica that has no monuments or buildings, and it propagates harmony with nature. This religion focuses on the individual and rejects the existing beliefs of Christianity and other religions followed in the Afro-Caribbean regions. A universal freedom that Rastafarianism propagated was communicated to Regga songs and poems. Now, some of the poets of this tradition are Mutabaruka, LKJ, Michael Smith, who were also the founders of the dub movement. Now, Christopher Laird, John Agard, Frederick Williams, Fred the Gear, Valerie Bloom, Ja Binta Breeze, and Lillian Allen are also part of this movement. Now, the dub movement has a specific language and rhythm and use vocal instruments to convey both cries and silences. LKJ is a Jamaican poet based in London. He is also widely considered to be the father of reggae dub. The next idea that we would be looking at is that the way that many of the Caribbean poets from different nationalities somehow have certain recurrent themes which connect them into a coherent whole. Now, Edward Camus Brathwaite from Barbados is one of the major Caribbean poet and historian, and for whom the creolized view of the Caribbean plays a major role in imagining the nation. The works of Brathwaite laid the foundation for the linguistic identity of the Caribbean region, the Creole identity that became one of the pedestals of Caribbean nationalisms. Through the nation language, Brathwaite insists that the nation finds its voices through English lexicon, through the contours, rhythm and timbre of English, which is not exactly the English of the oppressor. In the poem Wings of Dove, Brathwaite described the condition of a Rastafarian in a contemporary Caribbean society who, with a philosophical awe, also represents the poverty-stricken reality of the Caribbean nation. The next poet who we look at is, of course, Derek Walcott, the Nobel Prize winner from St. Lucia of 1992, whose poems demonstrate an urge to find the self and the identity of the land. Most of the characters of his poems and plays, they always are in an attempt to go back, to trace back an elusive past which many of them do not relate to. He goes back to classics and European influences just to realize that past is not enough to create an imagination of the future. Walcott is famous for revisiting Iliad and Odyssey in his epic poetry, Omeros. The sea, the islands, ships, gulls, sand and surf blended with European history and African heritage gave a platform for Walcott to reclaim the Caribbean identity. The next poet who we are looking at is again Jamaican, Ja Binta Breeze, who particularly writes about the condition of the women and their experiences along with the socially relevant themes. And it also, in a way, addresses a new perspective of the world of dub poetry, the voice of the fringe. As she was raised in rural Jamaica, her poems, linguistic and thematic structures displayed a natural way of expressing ideas in verse. Through her poems, she made her writings associate with rural Caribbean identities. Most of the time, the narrator would be a native woman who is struggling in another place where she's always considered to be a minority, always relegated to the fringes. Her poems represent minority communities, women, and also the Caribbean diaspora. The Jamaican-American poet Claude McKay, one of the old school Jamaican writers and poet, migrated to Harlem, New York, where he was also considered to be the seminal figure, one of the seminal figures in Harlem Renaissance, in which the African-American immigrants struggled for identity through art and literature. His 1922 poetry collection, Harlem Shadows, was one of the first books published during Harlem Renaissance. His other poetry collections are Songs of Jamaica, which was published in 1912, Spring in New Hampshire and Other Poems, published in 1920, and the Selected Poems of Claude McKay, which came out in 1953. Now, like his novels, his poetry also portrayed black individuals in search of identity in an intricately white world. Lorna Goodison, who is again a Jamaican, became one of the internationally famous contemporary Anglophone Caribbean writers who focuses on motherhood, sexuality and equality. And it also focuses on gender as well as racial issues. In a way, many of Lorna Goodison's poems talk about the double-edged oppression of which many African American or African women undergo due to their gender as well as their race. A blend of Jamaican Creole and English gives her poems a definite linguistic pattern that adds to the thematic prominence of Caribbean identity. However, most of her best poems celebrate womanhood and the different roles that women are sometimes forced to play throughout their life. The poem, "For My Mother, May I Inherit Half Her Strength," shows her respect and awe towards her mother. Her own experiences as a woman, a mother, and especially in a Jamaican context also highlight violence, poverty, and the politics with the stark realities of life. The Guyanan poet Martin Carter was one of the major poets from Caribbean who was part of the political movement for national independence. He was arrested by the British colonial government, and during his imprisonment, Carter wrote his most famous collection of poems, Poems of Resistance, which was published much later in 1954. His poems convey a strong political message with anger and frustration. However, he ends always with a positive note towards a bright future of the nation. Many of the present day Caribbean poets and writers consider him to be one of the old school adherents of a bright future without really questioning what future are they going to face. Now, this is the time that we need to look at some of the things that we have noticed thematically similar in both African and Caribbean poetry. We would notice that the mapping of the literary tradition of African and Caribbean poetry goes back to the oral customs and practices that still attempts to be the thematic structure of these two oeuvres. From a post-colonial perspective, a search for the possibilities of inventing or rediscovering an identity for the self and the nation becomes one of the foremost priorities in writing verse in these two geographical areas. The modern poetic techniques find the meaning of the self in the dilemma between the colonial past and the post-colonial present. The critical position that these and, of course, more poets that we could not have the time to look at represent creates a literature of their own, arising from a complex poetic tradition that limits them into a boundary, but also at the same time, it allows them to explore and recreate newer practices. Today's African and Caribbean poetry also have to deal with issues like globalization, ethnic conflicts, immigration, and multiculturalism. Forming a new canon also calls for international recognition, which many of the poets and literary aspirants of these two regions had to follow, which in turn would cause them to sacrifice their cultural and linguistic preferences to be able to reach out to the global audience. When the in-between identities gain more space and recognition through these poets, the question that remains is of tradition and modernity. How do they negotiate these two identities? Though these poets endeavor to create a balance between the dichotomies of identity, one has to be wary of the politics of inclusion and exclusion as well. Not all poets are included. How do we negotiate the canonization of these poets? How are they included in the anthologization of these oeuvres? Now, these are some of the questions that we need to keep in mind when we are looking into the dense and the intricately colorful poetic traditions of both the African nations and the Caribbean nations. Now, in this lesson, we have looked into some of the recurrent themes which riddle the African and the Caribbean consciousness. We have recognized that it is difficult and almost nigh impossible to create a pan-Caribbean or a pan-African consciousness. And we have also looked at the work and tendencies and recurrent tropes utilized by some of the African and some of the Caribbean poets. In the end of the lesson, there would be a module to assess your understanding of this lesson. And if you are more interested in pursuing the different ideas that we briefly looked into this lesson, there would also be a module which gives a list of books and articles in the Learn More section. Thank you.